This conference will now be recorded.
Shravani?
Yes,
Hello?
ma'am. Yes,
Yeah,
ma'am.
you can
Good
hear
morning,
me,
ma'am.
right? Yeah, good
Yes, ma'am.
morning. Okay, good morning, everyone. Today's class will be taken by Shravani. The topic is diabetic nephropathy. I hope everyone has sent your attendance to the meeting ID, the main ID. Okay, Shravani, I think you can start the class.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you're audible.
So, good morning, one and all present here. This is B. Satya Sarwani here to present on the topic diabetic nephropathy. So, as the name itself suggests, it's something related to diabetes mellitus. So, let us take a quick look on what is diabetes mellitus. So, diabetes mellitus is defined as a metabolic disorder with multiple etiology characterized by chronic hyperglycemia, which is prolonged increase in blood glucose levels with disturbances of carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism, resulting from decreased insulin production from the beta cells of pancreas, as in type 1 diabetes, or ineffective use of insulin by various body tissues, as in type 2 diabetes. And so, coming to diabetic nephropathy. Diabetes mellitus has many long-term complications, which include diabetic nephropathy, diabetic retinopathy, and diabetic neuropathy. And today I'm going to talk on diabetic nephropathy. So, diabetic nephropathy. It is also known as diabetic kidney disease and is defined as chronic loss of kidney function occurring in those with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus characterized by persistent albuminuria, progressive decline in glomerular filtration rate, and elevated blood pressure. And we'll see how this happens. So it is one of
That
the leading causes of
the complication
chronic
of
kidney
macrovascular
disease. Yes, ma'am.
complication. Diabetic nephropathy is microvascular complication or macrovascular complication?
Microvascular.
What are other microvascular complications?
Retinopathy.
And?
Neuropathy.
Okay. Continue.
Yes, ma'am. So it is one of the leading causes of chronic kidney disease and end-stage renal disease. So let us look at the epidemiology. So we know there is a recent prevalence of diabetes mellitus all over the world, and it is estimated to rise from 463 million in 2019 to 700 million in 2045. And coming to diabetic nephropathy, it is the most common cause of morbidity and mortality in both types of diabetes mellitus. And it is also one of the most common cause of end-stage renal failure in developed countries. And it accounts for about 20 to 60% patients starting renal replacement therapy. About 30% of type 1 diabetes mellitus patients have developed diabetic nephropathy after 20 years of diagnosis, but the risk factor falls below 1% per year. Let us take a look at the risk factors. So, genetic factors. A person who is having a family history of diabetic nephropathy is more likely to develop it. And who has inadequate glucose control, very high fluctuations in the glucose levels in the blood, and who has high blood pressure, usually it occurs as a result of kidney disease, but is also associated with progression and pathogenesis of nephropathy. Hyperlipidemia. As we already know, diabetes mellitus itself is a state of metabolic disorder, and there is a variation in metabolism of all the proteins, fats, and carbohydrates. And hyperlipidemia predisposes this diabetic nephropathy. Smoking, long-standing diabetes, pregnancy. We know pregnancy is a state of increased plasma levels, and as a result, there is a rise in GFR. More blood is reaching the kidneys, and there is a rise in renal blood flow and GFR, which actually returns to normal after delivery. But in hypertensive women and women who have renal disease prior to the conception, they have a higher risk of progression of the disease. So before going to the pathophysiology, let us just have a brief review on what is the structure of nephron. So a nephron is a functional unit of kidney, and it consists of an efferent arteriole, which brings in the blood, and the efferent arteriole, which takes out the blood. And in between, there is a structure of capillary network within the Bowman's capsule, which is called as the glomerulus. And the glomerulus in turn continues as the proximal convoluted tubule, the loop of Henle with the descending and ascending limbs, and the DCT, distal convoluted tubule, and the collecting duct. Here we can also observe the macula densa formed by the thick ascending limbo fluke of Henle. So coming to the pathophysiology. So the pathophysiologic abnormalities in diabetic nephropathy begins with a long-standing poorly controlled blood glucose levels. This is followed by multiple changes in the nephrons, the filtration units of kidney, and let's see what are the changes. So initially there is a constriction of the efferent arterioles, which is the arteriole which takes out the blood, and there is a dilation of the efferent arterioles which brings in the blood, with resulting increase in the glomerular hypertension. And how this happens means there is an increase in the renal blood flow when there is a dilation of the efferent arterioles and a constriction of the efferent arterioles. So more blood which is coming in is not going out. So as a result, there is a increase in the glomerular hypertension and hypofiltration as a result. This gradually changes to hypofiltration over time, and we'll discuss how that happens. And concurrently, there are changes in glomerulus, which include thickening of the basement membrane, widening of slit membranes of podocytes, increase in the number of mesangial cells, and increase in mesangial matrix. This matrix invades the glomerular capillaries and produces deposits called as Kimmelstein-Wilson nodules. The mesangial cells in the matrix can progressively expand and consume the entire glomerulus, which in turn disturbs the filtration, and ineffective filtration comes into play. The pathophysiology of diabetic nephropathy also includes a few hemodynamic and metabolic factors. But before that, let us take a view here. On the left side, we can see it's a normal glomerulus, and on the right side, it's a diabetic nephropathy glomerulus, where the arrow marks indicate of Kimmelstein-Wilson nodules. So the hemodynamic factors. These include an increase in the systemic and intraglomerular. Yes, ma'am.
One question: Kimmelstein-Wilson nodules, in which stage you'll get? We'll tell later.
No idea, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, when you tell the stages, I'll tell you which stage you'll get.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And once again, can you repeat the risk factors?
Yes, ma'am. So the risk factors include the genetic factors, inadequate glucose control, high blood pressure, hyperlipidemia, smoking, long-standing diabetes, and pregnancy.
Out of these, which is the most important risk factor?
Long-standing diabetes.
One can be the duration. The second one is your high blood pressure.
High blood glucose, inadequate control.
High blood pressure, inadequate control of the blood pressure.
Oh, okay.
These two comes in the top two.
So coming to the hemodynamic factors, these include an increase in the systemic and intraglomerular pressure, as well as an overactivation of RAAS, renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. So in a setting of diabetes mellitus, there are various factors which stimulate this RAAS. And in diabetic patients, we already know it's a state of hyperglycemia, and there is a increased load of filtered glucose, and due to which there is more glucose filtered into the glomerulus, into the Bowman's capsule, which because of which there is an upregulation of sodium glucose cotransporter 2, which is called as SGLT2, in the proximal tubules, which co-transports sodium and glucose back into the circulation. Here, due to the increased load of glucose, it tries to remove the excess glucose, and as a result, it uses the SGLT2, which along with the glucose transports sodium out of the PCT, and as a result, there's a decrease in the sodium chloride, which is reaching the macula densa in the distal tubules, and this in turn promotes a release of renin and overactivates RAAS.
One more question.
Yes, ma'am.
Which drugs acts on the SGLT2 receptor? Examples?
No.
I told you nine drugs acting.
Mom?
Which drugs acts on the SGLT2 receptor in the kidney?
ACE inhibitors, mom.
Which antidiabetic drugs? The blockage of SGLT2.
Yes, ma'am.
Is one of the mechanism for reducing your diabetes. You remember, yes, right? I have told you in drugs used in diabetes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What are the examples? The examples are your dapagliflozin, empagliflozin, and canagliflozin.
Okay.
Okay. That one. Second thing is, which is the most common side effect with these drugs? Malikarjun, unmute your mic.
Like UTIs.
Okay. Yeah. One more.
Increased urination.
Okay, one second. Malikarjun, what is the side effect of SGLT2 inhibitors? Apart from UTI and increased urination? No idea. Forgot what I taught in last class. There's increased chances of your fungal infections. Okay. And the last one is there's chance of your euglycemic decay. So this is why SGLT2 inhibitors will help in renal absorption of glucose, and that's why you give the inhibitors. Okay. Continue.
Okay. And another cause which can lead to the dysfunction of the nephrons include hyperfiltration. And in this, the glomeruli becomes hyperoxified and the filtration surface is initially increased, which later again decreases. And I'll let you know why. There is also an abnormal vascular control, which leads to reduction in efferent glomerular arteriolar resistance and increase in the efferent arteriolar resistance. Leading to more amount of blood reaching the kidney, which is increasing the renal blood flow and glomerular filtration rate as a result. So both the hyperfiltration and overactivation of RAAS lead to increased intraglomerular pressure. So there is more amount of blood coming in and more amount of filtrate formed. And because of this, there is an increased intraglomerular pressure, causing a stress on the endothelial cells and the mesangial cells and the podocytes. So this in turn exacerbates the dysfunction caused by the metabolic effects of hyperglycemia, which we will be discussing now. So the metabolic factors. So these include formation of advanced glycation end products, which are also called as AGEs. So these AGEs are chemical groups that form when reducing sugar. And as in this case, in diabetes mellitus, we can consider it as glucose. Reacts non-enzymatically with an amine group, predominantly the lysine and arginine, which have amine groups, which are then attached on proteins, lipids, and nucleic acids. And these glycosylation products accumulate on proteins of vessel wall, collagen, forming an irreversible complex called as cross-linked AGEs. And they produce their effects through a receptor-mediated mechanism, the most important being the receptor for advanced glycation end products, which is called as RAGE. RAGE is found in various cell types, including the macrophages, endothelial cells, renal, mesangial cells, and podocytes. Binding of the AGEs to the RAGE receptor enhances the production of cytosolic reactive oxygen species, ROS, as well as stimulates intracellular molecules such as protein kinase C, PKC, NFKB, and the activation of growth factors like TGF beta B and vascular endothelial growth factor VEGF. These factors, along with the hemodynamic changes which we have discussed earlier that occur, lead to a podocyte injury, oxidative stress, inflammation, and in the end stage, it also causes fibrosis. As the injury worsens, kidney function decreases and glomerular basement membrane becomes more permeable and less efficient in filtration. This leads to a progressive decline in the kidney function. And here I'd like to say, here we have discussed that initially there is an increase in the hyperfiltration, which later turns into hyperfiltration. And that is because of formation of glomerulosclerosis, which is also called as hilum glomerulosclerosis, which is due to the deposits in the efferent and efferent arterioles, which occludes the vessels as time, and the amount of blood reaching the kidney decreases with the development of the diabetic nephropathy, and hence there is a hyperfiltration which is observed in the later stages of diabetic nephropathy. So here we can see there is a because the SGLT2 transporter, it gets the glucose and sodium into the circulation. There's a decrease in the sodium delivery to the JGA and the macula densa, and hence RAAS is activated, and which leads to efferent arteriolar vasoconstriction and efferent arterial vasodilation. And this in turn, which as we already have discussed, efferent arterial vasodilation leads to more incoming of the blood, and due to vasoconstriction of efferent arteriole, there is less blood going out, and hence as a result there is more amount of blood in the glomerulus, which is increasing the intraglomerular pressure, and hence the hypofiltration. And here we can see due to the drugs what happens. This mechanism which I've just stated, due to the various drugs like the SGLT2 SGLT2 inhibitor, this mechanism is stopped, and hence the condition is improved.
One question.
So yes, ma'am.
What are the examples for advanced glycogen products or advanced glycoxylation end products? There are three things. One is pentosidin, glucosapine, and the final one is carboxymethyl lysine. Okay.
Okay.
Then one more thing is examples for GLP-1 analog agonists.
No idea.
Liraglutide, exenatide, albiglutide. Okay.
Okay.
Next.
Shall I continue now? So here, this is given in a flowchart, which I've already told before. So the PKC, protein kinase C, it activates many vasoactive hormones, endothelin, and which in turn acts on the cytokine and then releases the cytokines, TGF-beta, VEGF factors, and increases the extracellular matrix, which is a cause of extracellular matrix accumulation in proteinuria. Along with this, due to the flow and pressure, the hemodynamic factors, there is an increase in vascular permeability. We already know that increase in vascular permeability means there is more amount of proteins leaking into the urine, because they are generally not filtered into the urine. But due to the result of vascular permeability, there is proteinuria. And due to the glucose and other sugars, there is an advanced glycation product end products formation, and extracellular matrix cross-linking occurs. And this also leads to extracellular matrix accumulation. This is just a flowchart of what it is. Yes, ma'am.
Normally, how much amount of protein is lost in the urine? And out of which, how much amount of albumin is lost?
Like less than 30 mg is lost, mg per day.
Okay.
Albumin.
Basically, normally around 150 mg of protein is lost in the urine. That is the normal loss of protein. Out of which, the 30 mg is your albumin. The remaining component is basically formed by torn hosmer proteins.
Okay.
There, apart from that, you have immunoglobulins and other proteins. But the later part, that is from 30 to 150, is formed predominantly by your torn hosmer proteins.
Okay.
Continue.
Yes, ma'am. So we look at the stages of diabetic nephropathy. So there are five stages of diabetic nephropathy. The stage one is called as very early diabetes. And here we can observe hyperglycemia. And there is an increase in the glomerular filtration due to increased osmotic load on kidneys. As we know, glucose is a highly osmotic molecule. And there is, as a result, due to this osmotic load, it also drags more amount of liquid into the glomerulus, I mean into the Bowman's capsule, and there is more amount of glomerular filtration occurring in the nephrons. And there is an increased demand on the kidneys, indicated by above normal GFR, which is more than 90 ml per minute, and the size of kidney is increased. In stage two, which is called as developing diabetes, it is a clinically silent phase with continued hyperfiltration and hypertrophy, as we've already seen in stage one. It continues, the hyperfiltration and the hypertrophy continues in stage two, and the GFR might return to normal, but the glomerular damage progresses to significant microalbuminuria, means small but above normal level of protein albumin in urine.
So basically there are two stages, first two, stage one, stage two. Stage one is called stage of very early diabetes, or you can tell it is a stage of hyperfiltration or hyperperfusion.
Okay.
And GFR is increased.
Yes,
but in this stage, your blood pressure and your albumin excretion is normal. So this is in short stage one. Okay, in stage two, stage two is called silent diabetes. In these, your GFR also will be normal, your blood pressure also will be normal, and the amount of albumin excreted will be in the normal range. Okay, then continue.
Yes, ma'am. Then stage three, which is also called as overt or dipstick positive diabetes, and in this, the glomerular damage has progressed to clinical albuminuria with clinical albuminuria and with GFR 30 to 59 ml per minute. The basement membrane thickening due to AGEP is observed, and the urine is dipstick positive, and I'll be telling what is dipstick positive and about the dipstick test, containing more than 300 mg of albumin in 24-hour period. Hypertension also develops. In stage 4, which is the last stage diabetes, glomerular damage progresses with increased loss of albumin in the urine. As already in stage 3, there's a clinical albuminuria, and that progresses with increased loss of albumin in stage 4. And the kidney's filtering ability declines progressively, and the blood urea nitrogen, which is BUN and creatinine, CR, begin to increase. The GFR further decreases to about 15 to 29 ml per minute. And I've already stated why the GFR decreases, because of the glomerulosclerosis or hyaline glomerulosclerosis, which is observed in the efferent and efferent arterioles. And as a result, there is a decrease in the GFR. And in stage 5, or this is also called as end-stage renal disease or chronic kidney disease, in this, the damage of the filtration barrier is very high, and the GFR falls less than 15 ml per minute. And in at this stage, the option for treating the patient would be a renal replacement therapy, which is either through hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis, or a kidney transplantation is needed. Can I continue?
As I have told you before, Klemstein-Winston nodules you would see in stage 4. Okay. It is also called sometimes it's called as nodular glomerulosclerosis.
Okay.
And pathological findings, what you see in stage 3 are your thickening of basement membrane, mesangial expansion, and efferent and afferent arteriolar hyalinosis.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And stage 2, usually you won't see microalbuminuria, but exercise-induced microalbuminuria can be seen.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And stage 3 is the stage where your GFR starts to fall.
Yes, ma'am.
And your microalbuminuria can be appear in the urine.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And in stage 3, in case of type 1 diabetes, your blood pressure will be increased, but your type 2 diabetes, blood pressure is normal.
Okay.
Coming to stage 4, stage 5, it will follow. You're from micro, it will go to macroalbuminuria. Your blood pressure will continue to increase. Your GFR will decrease. Okay? So these are the characteristics of your staging.
Yes, ma'am.
And why your staging is important is, not only this, even the GFR staging, why is it important is, usually from stage 3, that is more than the stage 3 and above, you tell usually the kidney disease is not reversible. Only up to stage 1, stage 2, you'll tell it is reversible. So that is the significance of staging.
Yes.
And the GFR at which you try to initiate renal replacement therapy is around 20 to 15 ml per minute.
Okay.
Continue.
Yes. So how we are going to diagnose this diabetic nephropathy? Actually, these patients don't generally present with any clinical symptoms, and the diagnosis should be made as early as possible after knowing that they're diabetic. So how we're going to do this diagnosis? One will be ultrasonography. So immediately after the diagnosis of type 2 diabetes and 5 years after the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes, ultrasonography is recommended. And this helps in differential diagnosis of other suspicions like the UTIs, urinary tract obstructions, kidney stones, and polycystic kidney diseases. And coming to the urine analysis, so generally the urine analysis is done for albumin. So in albumin, so we know that albumin is a protein which is produced by the liver, which makes up roughly about 50 to 60% of the proteins in the blood, while others make about the rest. And the proteins other than albumin, such as immunoglobulin, they make up 40 to 50%. And this is why, and it's not observed generally observed in the urine. So this can be taken as a sensitive test. The levels can be taken as a sensitive test for diabetic nephropathy. And generally, the normal albuminuria will be less than 30 mg per 24 hours. And microalbuminuria ranges from 30 to 299 mg per 24 hours. Macroalbuminuria greater than or equal to 300 mg per 24 hours. And coming to the dipstick test. So conventionally, proteinuria, or in this case, the albuminuria, can be diagnosed by simple dipstick test. So this is done by using test strips, which contain some reagents on them. And these are used to detect the specific substances which we need. And in this case, to detect the albumin and detect the albuminuria, bromophenol blue, which is highly specific to albumin, is used on the strip. So the protein dipstick measurements, which we get, they should not be confused with the protein detected on the test for microalbuminuria, which denotes values for protein for urine in mg per day. Here I've shown you normal albuminuria and all this. It's per one day, but in this dipstick test we get measurements in mg per dl. So that is, there is a basal level of proteinuria that can occur below 30 mg per day, which is considered as non-pathology. Values between 30 to 300 mg per day are termed microalbuminuria, which are considered as pathologic. Urine protein lab values for microalbuminuria greater than 30 mg per day correspond to a detection level within the trace to 1 plus range of the urine dipstick protein assay. I'll be showing a chart on what this means. And therefore, positive indication of any protein detected on the urine dipstick assay obviates any need to perform a urine microalbumin test, as the upper limit for microalbuminuria has already been exceeded. So here we can see the concentration of the albumin in dipstick test and the microalbumin urea test, and the trace designation is on the very left. Okay. And another diagnosis can be done through the glomerular filtration rate, and as we've already seen in stage one, there is an increase, and from stage two it slowly declines, and the specific decline in the glomerular filtration rate can be observed from stage three, four, and five. And in stage one, there is more than 90 ml per minute to 1.73 meters square, and in stage two it is 60 to 89, in stage three 30 to 59, stage four 15 to 29, and stage five less than 15 ml, which I've already shown in various stages. And another diagnosis can be done through the biomarkers. So although albuminuria is used as the most frequently used marker of diabetic nephropathy, it has a few limited sensitivity, as many patients with diabetic nephropathy experience GFR loss and glomerulosclerosis without immediate elevation in the albuminuria. So we already know that glomerulosclerosis means there is a constriction, I mean, there is accumulation of substances around the arterioles, and there is a reduced renal flow. And before even we can observe the albumin in the urine, there could be the sclerosis, and hence sometimes we get negative in the previous tests which I have stated for albumin. And hence we can use cystatin C, which is a protein that is freely filtered in the glomeruli before it is reabsorbed and catabolized in the renal tubular cells. And its serum level is independent of the muscle mass, making more accurate the estimating GFR than creatinine serum levels. Coming to the treatment and management. So the treatment, yes, ma'am.
What are the other causes of albuminuria? One is your renal.
If there is more amount of protein production by in the body, ma'am.
Okay, then examples of conditions I'm asking. Basically, a febrile illness, urinary tract infection, a severe hyperglycemia, severe hypertension, vigorous exercise, any hematuria, or any heart failure will cause albuminuria. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
What is the transient albuminuria? Usually, albuminuria is not persistent. It's present only for some time. Okay. That is called transient albuminuria.
Okay.
What is orthostatic proteinuria?
No idea, ma'am.
The proteinuria will be present only if the patient is standing. the patient is lying down, there won't be any proteinuria. Okay, that is called orthostatic hypoproteinuria.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So coming to the treatment and management of diabetic nephropathy, this includes the blockade of RAAS. As we've already seen that the major complications are due to the overactivation of RAAS, which is by either using the ACE inhibitors or angiotensin II receptor blockers, which are called as ARBs, along with other antihypertensive agents, is recommended as the first-line therapy. So by blocking this RAAS, there is a reduction in the angiotensin II mediated vasoconstriction of efferent arterioles in glomeruli, therefore resulting in dilation of the vessels, decreasing the glomerular filtration pressure, and therefore hyperfiltration and protein leak is also decreased. Additional use of diuretics, NOROS, salt restriction increases both the antiproteinuric and antihypertensive effect of angiotensin blockade, and therefore constitute the second line treatment. Both the ACE inhibitors and the ARBs increase the risk of hyperkalemia, and in presence of renal artery stenosis, it may induce marked deterioration of renal function. Therefore, in such conditions, it is necessary to check the electrolytes and the renal function of the patient who is undergoing this treatment. If the blockade of RAAS is not possible, then the blood pressure should be managed with standard treatment with calcium channel blockers and diuretics. Spironolactone, which is an aldosterone antagonist, can be used, but it is limited in hyperkalemia, as stated above. And along with these, blood pressure should be managed and maintained at normal levels. HbA1c should be managed, and protein intake should be reduced. Lipid management and aspirin therapy is also useful. And when there is a progressive decline in the condition, and when the patient reaches the final stage, which is ASRD and CKD, which is end-stage renal disease and chronic kidney disease, and such stage, ma'am,
what is the other name for ASRD?
Chronic kidney disease.
No, one more. Chronic kidney disease, okay. One more.
No idea, ma'am.
Interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy.
Okay,
that is one more name for ASRD.
Yes. So in such conditions, when the drug therapy is not working and when the patient is progressing to stage 5 and is already in stage 5, then a renal replacement therapy, which is by hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis, and renal transplantation is usually the preferred route of treatment. So here we can see this is a hemodializer. We've already learned about the hemodialysis, and this is a peritoneal dialysis in patients, and it's a transfer section, of course. Thank you.
So you have told regarding what is the treatment of diabetic nephropathy, the kidney as such.
Yes, ma'am.
Then how do you treat diabetes in the patients who are having kidney disease? You can give all the OHAs, you can give all the medications.
No, ma'am.
What all you can't give, what all you can give?
Don't know, ma'am.
So first, coming to your insulin therapy. Okay, usually insulin therapy, the dose is decreased because insulin is degraded basically by the kidney. Okay. So since the kidney is not functioning properly, your insulin is not degraded and the serum level will increase. And that's why the requirement of the insulin will reduce. Okay. Any case where insulin is metabolized in the kidney? PCT, DCT?
Yes, ma'am.
Where the insulin is metabolized? PCT, DCT?
In the
which part?
Don't know, ma'am.
It can occur anywhere, okay?
Okay.
So the requirement will reduce, the insulin requirement, because it's not degraded, and as such the renal gluconeogenesis will decrease.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is regarding insulin. In coming to OHAs, the most commonly used OHA like metformin, if the GFR is less than 45, you have to do dose modifications. And if GFR is less than 30, you have to stop.
Okay.
That is regarding your metformin. And your sulfonylureas are absolute contraindication to be used in CKD, but only your sulfonylurea like glipizide and gliclazide can be used.
Yes.
Coming to SGLT2 inhibitors, those are not used if your GFR is less than 30.
Okay.
Thiazolinurones can be used. What is the example for thiazolinurones? Thiazolinidiones.
Pioglitazone.
Okay, good. Then two more.
Rosiglitazone.
Okay, one more.
No idea.
Troglitazone. That is not used in this.
Okay.
And your liraglutide and GLP-1 analogs can be used. Coming to your gliptins, your linagliptin and denagliptin can be used.
Okay.
So these are the things where you use in diabetes.
Yes, ma'am.
For medications, for treatment, treating the diabetic part of the patient. What you have told is your nephropathy part, that is fine.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm asking
yes, ma'am.
The diabetic part. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Suppose type 1 diabetic patients presented you. Two patients had come. One is type 1,
yes,
one is type 2.
Yes, ma'am.
For type 1 diabetic patients, when do you check for nephropathy? For type 2, when do you check for nephropathy?
No idea.
For type 1, you check after 5 years. Okay.
Okay.
For type 2, you check immediately for
nephropathy. After the nephropathy.
Immediately after the diagnosis of the diabetes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. That is the thing. Type 1 and type 2, in which diabetic nephropathy is common?
In type 1.
No, it is
type
equal.
2. Sorry, type.
The incidence is equal in both type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes.
Okay.
Okay. So, this is regarding diabetic nephropathy. You have to know regarding the stages, the statistic feature of the stage, and the treatment part.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And for reducing proteinuria, what do you give? What drugs you give for reducing proteinuria? You just told me.
Antihypertensive drugs.
Like? What is the mechanism for proteinuria?
Due to hemodynamic factors, there is an increase in GFR now. And the,
okay.
Due to the filtration barrier, the ineffective filtration takes place because the barrier deteriorates. There is more amount of protein loss in the urine.
Basically, your ACE inhibitors can be used. Your ARBs
yes,
can be used.
Okay.
Okay. And
yes,
calcium channel blockers also can be used, like verapamil and diltiazem.
Yes.
So these are the four drugs which are used to reduce the proteinuria.
Yes.
Okay, then one more question is, in ACE inhibitors and ARBs, which are better or both the same?
No idea.
ARBs are better.
Okay.
Okay, and one more thing is, the ACE inhibitors are preferred in type 1 diabetes and ARBs are preferred in type 2 diabetes.
Okay.
Okay, so what you have told regarding the kidney part is fine.
Yes, ma'am.
But you have to include these also.
Okay.
So that's all for today's class.
Yes,
I hope everyone has sent attendance, right? Once can you check and tell me how many I've got? Sharwani.
Yes, ma'am.
Once can you check and see in the chat box how many numbers are there?
Okay, ma'am.
In the yes, chat box, really, there'll be the numbers 120, 121. How many numbers are there? You can't see anything.
There are no, ma'am.
Okay. I'll see that. And next week, who is presenting?
I have no idea, ma'am.
No, no, I'm not asking you. I'm asking you in general. Next week, who is presenting? Yes. Mallikarjun?
Vinita, ma'am.
Vinita, are you there today?
Ah, yes, ma'am.
You can't reply.
Ma'am, some network issues.
Are you there in the class or you just joined and you left the class?
No, ma'am, I'm there, ma'am.
What is the topic for you for next week?
Diabetic neuropathy, ma'am.
Okay. By when will you send the PPT to me?
This Saturday I'll send, ma'am.
Okay. By Saturday, maximum, I want your PPT. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
And Sharwani, good job. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Shall I end it, ma'am?
End the meeting. You can stop the recording and end the meeting.
Yes, ma'am.